It's honestly, I can't even explain it. You have to do it. It was literally the greatest thing I've done in a long time.
No, no, no. What? Like, did I win?
Did you beat the whole thing?
Wait.
One in a billion, I think. As a creator, it's your job.
You work in the social media space. You've been doing it for quite a while now.
Yes.
You're an expert.
Yes, maybe. The fact that we're all okay with this is insane. Trend climbing, creator burnout.
That side of AI horrifies me.
My personal opinion is that AI is extremely dangerous.
Mic 1, 3, 4, 5.
That's so great.
This is Anything and Everything, a space for creators, talent, and entertainers such as comedians, actors, models, musicians, and creatives bring production to life. A place to be seen, to be heard, to share their stories and advice with the world, and a place to be celebrated.
Always do what you are afraid to do.
Trust me, you are not going to want to miss this. Be sure to tune in to the YouTube channel every Friday. See you guys then. Welcome back. I'm your host, Jessica Shea, and today we have coffee connoisseur and social media sensation, Jordan Beau. Good to see you again.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thanks for recording.
It's cozy.
First couple of episodes weren't as cozy because I didn't have everything like in the mail.
Yeah.
Finally got the vibe going. It's probably going to change as we upgrade equipment. And like, let's get to know Jordan a little bit more. Who are you and like, what do you do?
Oof, that's a loaded question. I'm a veteran content creator. So I'm creating content for coming up on a decade now. I'm an ex-professional scooter rider. That's another thing people don't know about me. I do a lot of creative consulting. I am a self-proclaimed visionary.
Okay, I love that.
Yeah.
So you work in the social media space. You've been doing it for quite a while now.
Yes.
You're an expert.
Yes, maybe.
Okay, so what platforms are you on?
All of them.
All of them.
Yeah.
Which ones are your favorite?
For longevity, as far as like actually building a career, I think YouTube is the only platform that sort of checks all the boxes. I like Instagram from like a user standpoint. I have my gripes. I don't like that they've gone more towards video. It just seems like they're trying to be TikTok. I kind of wish every platform stayed in their lane. I do like Instagram. Instagram sort of like reminds me of like the central hub for content creation. Like if I find someone on YouTube, I want to go see their Instagram. If I meet someone who's a creator, I want to go to their Instagram. But YouTube is where you build a career. It's where you like posted a TV show or a series or document something. Like, and I think short form is obviously becoming more and more prominent. And I have fallen more and more in love with it, sort of just accepting it as it is and that I can't really get away from it. But I still think YouTube is untouchable. I'm a little biased because that's my platform. But social media, it was sort of the first time it became a career because I used to ride scooters professionally. Me and my brother started a YouTube channel together, which I can get into. We had a following on other platforms, just a social media presence within, as like an athlete in the sport. And so we'd always been making videos and we'd work with sponsors, which were less like brands now, but they were like the same thing as sponsored athletes. And we would post content for them. And then we finally hopped on YouTube around sort of pre-golden era of YouTube when vlogging sort of started, when all the pranksters started kind of showing the behind the scenes of their lives. That's when we hopped on YouTube. So it's pretty early on to like what we know of YouTube as today. But I would say YouTube was like the time when everything sort of, it was like that inflection point when like it became a career outside of scootering. When it was like, I became a content creator rather than I was creating content as an athlete.
Got it.
Yeah.
Okay, so most of your original content is like sports and athletic stuff, like scooter, outdoor activities.
Yes, scootering. And then we quickly went to like trampolines and just started trend climbing really at the beginning.
Yeah. Sounds like a lot of fun, actually. You started making money on YouTube very early on. So social media monetizing is something that you're very familiar with.
Yes, very much so.
Okay, cool. So what platform would you say you've made like the most money at? You don't have to say how much.
No, you're good.
But like which one? For creators, they would like to know where to spend their time. And for somebody who like has only a little bit of time and like capitalize on just one, and not really waste your time on others if it's not paying.
I laugh because it's YouTube by like in couple figures of zeros.
Yeah.
But that's not to say that if you're a content creator, I think the first decision you make, again, shouldn't be where is it more profitable. It should be like what format fits me as a creator. If you keep up with TikTok, you keep up with Reels, right? A lot of today's biggest content creators are short form creators. And you can kind of tell that like, I'm not going to name drop, but there's a lot of creators I'm like, well, you work for short form. You could vlog on YouTube, but your little daily videos you film on TikTok are great. And like it works with your personality and there's more output versus like one vlog a week on your channel. You've got something going on every day in your life, that would be a lot of work to make a full format video. So like short form might work for you. And I know creators who have made 7 figures plus just doing short form. Like, I mean, we know a lot of obviously like TikTokers.
Yeah.
As derogatory as that term may be, have made a lot of money from other platforms. I'm working with brands. And I think brands are spending a lot more money on these short form platforms now. I just think YouTube is the king
of monetizing a platform as it is, right? Like the only other platforms that have decent monetization programs are going to be TikTok, but they're constantly behind. There's only a beta right now. Reels was okay for a little. Snapchat was sort of crazy. But again, these are all like platforms testing and investing a lot of their own money into building a monetization system in the platform, whereas YouTube's been doing it for, I think, over a decade now. So
TikTok just came on the scene, so they're still trying to learn how to do all that.
Correct.
You create content right now, right? Like I see sometimes you post and stuff. I'm very interested in what you post. You post a lot of coffee stuff. I love coffee.
I do.
Really.
I do.
So, and then I also see that you post a lot of skating. You skate a lot. Something original.
Sometimes, yeah.
Original content. Also, like a lot of your like fashion, shopping, thrifting is very interesting to me because I love thrifting. And you also make it like comedic too. So tell us about like your content creating right now. Like what like getting a video out looks like.
So I've been on a mild YouTube hiatus. It's like my YouTube journey the past 2 years has been a lot. I sort of dove into so many niches along the career of my YouTube, and I was in a relationship. And so like my audience is comprised of like so many different seasons of content creation for me, which sort of deemed a problem maybe in 2021, maybe early 2022, when I was kind of in like a transitioning point in both my life and in content. And I didn't really know what content I wanted to make. And also the algorithms, to my knowledge, were sort of confused on like, who is his audience, right? I spent like a year trying to commit to like one format of video, one type of video, as authentic as I could be. And the algorithm just never really picked it up. YouTube being my main source of income, my main career, I had this sort of like attachment to it where I just never wanted to let go, rightfully so. I just kind of got to a point finally through consulting and doing some other things that were sort of able to like alleviate the financial burden and like necessity of YouTube. And so for the first time, I'd say maybe 6 months ago, I got to a point where I was like, you know what? Like I've always wanted a break from YouTube, and I've taken these like sporadic creator burnout breaks where I'm just like, I'm gonna work on me and do whatever. Never able to like let go of it. And so for the past 6 months, it's been like the first time really since 2016 that I've taken some time off of YouTube. Maybe I've posted a vlog or two just here and there, throwing together footage or whatever. But right now I would consider myself like MIA from YouTube as a platform. But because I love creating content so much and my personal brand is, I mean, something I've worked on for a decade, I will always continue posting across all platforms. I've really disconnected from like performing and like figures and like, how are my photos doing? Who's commenting? What brands am I like? I don't really care about that much. And again, I'm sure we'll get into more of what I'm doing right now. But yeah, for the first time in a while, I just create content for fun, really. And then I use my knowledge base to actually fund my life and consult and work with brands and creators. It's been a good balance.
Okay. So speaking of leaving YouTube, there was a video I happened to see on your YouTube channel that said something about like a dopamine detox or social media detox, something in that nature. Maybe there was like more than one video. Feel good to do that? Or like, do you suggest every once in a while creators like take the time to maybe step away? Even if it's like your pay, you just have to find like that really good time to say, hey, like I need a break.
I would more so suggest anybody step away. I'd suggest your average person step away than a creator, because as a creator, it's your job. Like, right, like work's not butterflies every day. Mm-hmm. And if you work in like a, this is gonna be real harsh, it's very blue collar of me right here. You work in like a steel mill, right? Like I'm sure you have those days where like, I don't wanna go to work, but you have to show up, you have to be there, right? So as a creator, you almost have more of an obligation to be on social media than anyone else. Mm-hmm. And I understand there's creator burnout, and there's definitely a whole other conversation there about like how creators can balance their work and certain tools, and people are working on stuff to alleviate creator burnout. But when I did the detox, I realized two things. A, it's not that realistic for a creator to take 7 days or 2 weeks entirely off social media. Because when you do a detox, you're not using your phone or really anything other than communication. And if it is, great. And I would recommend it. It was literally the greatest thing I've done in a long time. You might be, I don't want to speak for you, but like most people are massively addicted to what's on our phones. And if you just, I'm like one of those people, I walk around in like a mall or I'm at a restaurant, I look around, it like kind of scares me to see everyone with their head in their phones. I mean, I'll be on a walk, and I do it too. I'm not preaching from a pedestal here, but I'll be on a walk and everyone's on their phone. Like
a
bigger percentage of our world feels like it's in our device than it is here. But detox is massively beneficial, and you'll realize once you take 7 days off from like 5 to 7, how much more alive you feel, how much better you're sleeping. It's honestly, I can't even explain it. You have to do it. If you haven't done one, you need to do it.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to try this because I don't know how long it's been that I've taken a long period of time away from social media. And I just every day, I'm that person with my phone in my face.
Yeah.
Speaking of TikTok and like monetization, went to go look at your TikTok because I know that you said you do a lot of TikTok stuff. And I saw you were live, hopped it, and you were doing like this battle thing. And I at first was like, what's happening here? Somebody who is new to the space doesn't really know what they're doing. I went and bought stuff, right? I'm like, he needs help, right? Roses and gifts or something. Can you tell me what this is, what it is about, why is it so popular? Do creators make money off of it?
Did you have fun?
Yeah, of course. It's for entertainment, obviously. Like, are you getting monetary?
So TikTok introduced a tool called Battles. It was like TikTok Battles. It's sort of been something that's been on TikTok for a long time. Like, I used to have a TikTok Live podcast, and I remember there was like always this little match button, and like none of us really knew what it meant. But like every once in a while, you know, if you're on live with your friend, or anyway, I don't want to speak for everyone because clearly there were some early adapters of this tool. But like, to my knowledge and most of my friends and like the general population of creators, it was just something we played around with. And yeah, it seems like both teams are gifting you things, but we didn't really know what it was. But I had some sort of general knowledge about it. And then maybe 4 months ago, I got approached. I don't remember who, and if I did, I probably wouldn't speak on who it was anyway, by essentially like an agency. And they were like, hey, I didn't really know it was an agency at the time, but it was like a group of really cool kids, and I liked what they were doing. And they kind of explained to me like, hey, this is a huge opportunity here. And being someone that sort of missed out on like financial opportunities in social media, because I've been here for a while. So like, I missed out on Snap Spotlight for the most part. Like, I have a lot of friends who made, some people made millions of dollars on Spotlight. I missed out on like a lot of the early short form content buzz. And so this was one of those opportunities where I was like, you know what? You should have given me seltzer water.
That has bubbles.
I'm burping all the time. I got to a point where I was like, well, I'm at a point right now where it's like, I'm only going to do stuff I enjoy doing. So like, that's my number one rule. So I was like, hey, this sounds interesting. I like the people who are doing it. I like what they're doing and like how they're using the tool. Obviously, yes, one of the big things they pitched was like, yeah, it's super monetized. A lot of us are seeing crazy returns. And I was like, I'll tell you what, I'll give it a go. And if I have fun doing it, I'll continue to do it. And me, I've always loved being live. I'm sure you can tell it. I enjoy being in front of cameras. I love talking. I actually talk too much. And so I started going live, and very, very quickly, I was like, I like this. This is fun. My big fear was like, I was going to feel like I was asking for money. But like, I think everyone in the community right now, this is like something that's super popping right now. I cannot imagine how many creators are on there and how many users are actually on there playing. But every night, it's a massive community of people and beyond. And yeah, everyone has fun. No one's asking for gifts. The community really wants to play these battles. Like, it's really hard for me to explain this to people, and I can't sit here and say I understand it entirely, because sometimes I do question like, that person just spent a lot of money tonight. Like, why? You know what I mean? Like, what do they get out of it?
Yeah.
But I think it's the same thing of like when you pay, this is going to be a little bit of a stretch, but like you buy Call of Duty and you pay for your Xbox Live membership, like you're paying to play. The difference is this is the same thing as they're paying to play. I'm there providing entertainment, hyper stimulation because they're playing something. I'm there, whoever I'm battling is there. We're all entertaining. They get to feel like they're on a FaceTime call with their favorite creators, and no one's forcing them to pay, right? So I have most of the people who are like my family, or whatever you want to call your group of people that are on with you consistently, they don't spend anything. They don't even have gifts turned on. They just hang out. And I tell everyone, like, you do not need a gift. If that's what you want to do and that's fun, that's your prerogative, great. And that's really the goal, is just like build a massive family of people you get to hang out with every day. And I know I'm dragging this on really, really hard, but like, yeah, it's just a cool way to get to know fans and meet new audience members. It feels like a little like Zoom family every night that has some sort of interactive aspect to it.
Okay, so you get more personal with your fan base.
Correct.
And you obviously have no problem with caring, entertaining, and being able to have these people join and have a good time.
Yes.
Which is very obviously important for that type of gig, because some people get on there and they're not as entertaining, right? In real life, like in real time.
I also will say I get so, like, I think because I have like a switch for social media, like just by nature, like when a camera's on, I'm not playing a character, but there's like this elevated version of myself. And I feel like I'm on, like we're on a podcast or a talk show, whatever it is. And so for me, like some of these kids are live from like literally 10 hours a day. And I'm like, I do 2 hours and I feel like I was just performing for 2 hours. I'm like, I need to go to sleep.
Exhausted.
I'm drained. Yeah.
Yeah. It can take a lot out of you when you're really like on, constant, mm-hmm. on, aware, alert, interactive. I saw Jeffree Star on there too. So I guess there are like really big creators who could take time to.
He's always on there.
Yeah.
He's like one of the most prominent people.
Yeah. People were like, on another one talking about, I'm gonna hop over and try to get on live 10, and I'm like what's going on?
And that is proof, essentially, not that I needed to defend the platform, like it's fun to where you don't need to do it for the money, because Jeffree Star, I don't even want to know how much money he makes.
Yeah.
The money he makes on TikTok is not prominent in comparison, and it's definitely not worth his value for time, right? Like, right. Jeffree Star could allocate that time he's on live far better elsewhere. but he enjoys it.
Right.
And it is an enjoyable thing. I mean, obviously when you're definitely starting, you're sitting at the top of the leaderboards every day and the whole world's in there. I get it. But yeah, it is a really fun thing to do, especially with, he has fans too. Like, he has his own community and I'm sure he finds joy in that somehow.
Do you ever think that maybe he's like on a secret account, like giving those really big tips back to the community?
Oh, he gifts crazy. No, I know he does, but he gifts from his account.
Oh, well, he's isn't a secret.
No. Like, I have a friend, a good friend of mine. She's like one of the biggest streamers I know. And she's gotten gifts from him all the time. He throws like the biggest, he doesn't care. And the other cool thing with the platform too is all the money sits in like your TikTok balance, right? And you can exchange that balance to gift people. So like, technically, and I know like it's the same concept, it's because it's kind of some girl math here, okay? Where it's like the money's in your account. And even though you made that money, it feels less like money made. You feel less guilty spending that money than like tangible cash, because it's just sitting in your account. You're like, I made it. These people were gracious enough to give it to me, so I'm going to go spread the love. So like, I'll have times when I go on and I go gift all my friends, right? And I've gifted people like $50, $100 gifts before, like that. In theory, but they are people who have gone and spread love. But like, my audience spreads love to me, right? Now I've got this balance, right? And I will go out and just gift my friends, but I'll spend $100 and feel no guilt. Where like, if I go to a restaurant, like a $100 meal, I'm like, hell no, like I'm frugal. I don't want to do that. But this money feels less tangible. So I think Jeffree Star probably throws money at people because he makes so much on the app, I'm sure. And also I don't think he's doing it for like financial gain.
So you can cash out.
I think it cashes out every week, once a week. It's quick.
Awesome. What do you think about AI for creators?
It's actually very interesting because that's a lot of the stuff I do for consulting.
Yeah, tell us some more about the consulting to me.
I can't necessarily, but I can at least chime in, and this will sort of be backed by like a lot of the work that I have done. I think it's massive, the future, whether I support AI or not. My personal opinion is that AI is extremely dangerous. I watched a podcast between the founder of OpenAI. You know who OpenAI is? They're the ones who own ChatGPT. The probably the heaviest player in AI right now. I feel like we talk about AI getting consciousness from sci-fi movies and we laugh it off. But like, these guys are talking about this and they're not joking. Like, he'll ask you, like, it was two people. Obviously, he's extremely intelligent about AI. And the other person was Lex Fridman, who's also very, very intelligent in that space. And the founder of OpenAI asked him, like, he was curious, like, do you think it has a consciousness? Are we just asking these questions right now? And like, no one's like, we're all okay with that. That side of AI horrifies me. It used to sort of be like, Jordan, like, it's sci-fi, it's not a big deal. But now that I see like the heavy players of the game open to the idea that it could already have developed some sort of consciousness, it's not okay to me. And the fact that we're all okay with this is insane. But besides the point, as far as its utility goes, it's massive for creators. I do think we're behind. From my experience, a lot of people in the business, in the tech space, and in the creator space are all working on developing the tech and sort of applying it and figuring out, like, how do we build tools? Can we use AI to solve the biggest creator problem, such as creator burnout? What is burning out creators? Is it editing? Is it conceptualization for videos, ideation, whatever? And how can we use AI to sort of lighten their workload? And so, yes, I think it's helpful. Yes, it's going to be around. I just don't think, like, I don't personally use it for anything yet. The only thing I've dabbled around with is ChatGPT. And tools that I've used for consulting, and they're helpful, but I don't need them. And most of the time, I'm really just using them to get better at prompting and to get better at using the tools. I haven't used any for editing. You use them, so you could probably shine more light. And I'd love to know what you were literally explaining to me earlier, that you've used AI editing. I haven't even dabbled with any of that. I've really just used it for like, make me a cool photo of me doing this. And I don't usually use it for anything. It's really just for fun.
A lot of people could benefit from it optimizing work time. But for me, like, I just don't think it does the same type of editing or work that I like see as a human being.
Yeah.
With emotions and structure, out AI to have some sort of like, probably give it the outline that you need to make sure that it gets to those certain points. But it's just such an extensive tool to use to get it the way you want it as perspective from human. Are you looking to have a future in content creating or monetizing social media in the future?
Ideally, I don't ever want to rely on social media / content creation as my source of income, as my security. That's been one of the things that I've sort of not enjoyed for so long, is like just the roller coaster of social media as from like a financial standpoint. I will probably always create content. I don't know whether that's documentation of business I'm running or just for fun. And I will always be a creative. So for example, one of the big things I'm working, actually pretty much the main thing I'm working on right now, is launching my apparel brand. So in the future, I will be creative directing for both apparel and for shoots and for content and running socials and branding and building both a personal brand as a founder and the brand of my companies. I'm definitely a pure blood creative. I just don't ever want to rely on the financial aspect of social media as my source of income, to be honest. And again, I might find a career in YouTube or something again, but I sort of hope I don't.
Yeah. I'm also just somebody who started at a very young age, and like, there's just so much more to life. And,
yeah.
And when you've experienced it at an early time in your life, it's like one of those things where in 10 years from now, I'm not as interested and don't care and you want to do something else. Is there something else like besides the consulting that you want to do this outside of social media?
Apparel will probably be the furthest thing out, like building a clothing brand. These days, when you're building a clothing brand, especially if it's like an e-com based direct-to-consumer brand, you're still going to be very prominent on social media, right? Because I love it so much, I will happily do that, because it's not necessarily a financial necessity. It is maybe for the business, but I'm not like waiting on how did this ad perform for like Facebook monetization. It's like, no, how many sales did we convert with this ad? Or how did this campaign do? Or how did the consumer of the brand enjoy the campaign, seeing the product in this light, rather than how much money did this post generate me?
Yeah, so you still be involved in analytics and on the front end of the business that you're planning on creating in apparel. So are you considering doing fashion shows?
It'll be in the fashion industry. The question with fashion shows is something I think about. I think with direct to consumer being so prominent now, like the fashion show world is sort of like, I don't want to call it the outdated world of fashion, but it's almost like a parallel. Like the traditional fashion space and the direct to consumer space, they have merged, obviously, because a brand, any of the big fashion houses that are doing fashion shows, whether it's Prada, Fendi, Off-White, I don't know, I can name a million, or all of those fashion houses are still doing direct to consumer. Like you can still buy Louis Vuitton online, I'm sure. You can buy these products online. And so yes, they've merged, but they still exist separately. So like I could name brands that just do direct to consumer and have never done a fashion show in their life and probably won't. And I can name these big fashion houses and even brands that even newer brands such as like Reese Cooper, who sort of got their start in the fashion game, doing fashion shows in Paris, planning out their next season to run it through the coolest show so it gets the eyes from that side. It's like there's two different worlds. And so I've thought about it. I have cool ideas for fashion shows. Sounds really stressful. It sounds more like the traditional way of doing things. And the direct to consumer seems like a more financially sound way of doing it. And though I'm not creating clothing to make money, I'm doing it because I genuinely love the space. I love design. I love all that stuff. It seems so much less stressful to go the other route. So I don't know. I can't answer that question. So that was really long and dragged out.
So as far as like your apparel brand, like are we going to be like messages or like concept dropped around some sort of like when you have a drop or something? Is there like a message you're trying to...
There's a lot of different things. And obviously it's new and it's what I've been working on every day. The brand's called Same But Different. And I'm sort of trying to like, I know what it is. I know what it's about. I know the ethos. It's just, I'm trying to find the right words. I'm trying to find how to articulate the ethos. And like the best to my knowledge right now, like the best way I can articulate what the brand is about is essentially like, and I'll try to just not apply it to the name, but you can sort of have your own observation on that. But like, I think the whole world operates in these strict guidelines, right? Like we don't even realize it, but like we have this code, like this human code that we operate in. And sometimes we forget that like a lot of these things, I'm not talking about the law, I'm just talking about how the world works. And like pants have two pockets, four pockets, a zipper, and they end here, right? Like, and I'm trying to use apparel to kind of make the connection. You don't have to do that though. Like that doesn't have to be a pair of pants. Okay, social media people in content creation, you should post X amount of times on these platforms, whatever, or don't, right? Like you don't have to do anything. These confines that we've created in the world, and as an apparel designer, I sort of want to purposely not follow a lot of those confines. I've always had fun doing that, whether it's something that's ironic and doing something that most people wouldn't do, or as the way that I see myself as a visionary is I'm always seeing stuff from angles that I'm like, there's no way people are thinking the way that I do. And I'm not saying that from a pedestal. I'm not saying it's a better way of thinking. I just think differently than most people. I really want my fashion company, my brand to encompass that. My concept for the first drop, because it's something I want to start slow and it takes a lot of money and cost to get into apparel, you have to sort of figure out what are your drops going to look like. The start, I wanted to do one garment, just one garment drop. So it's like, I'm dropping a t-shirt on this day, you can buy it. I'm dropping an outerwear piece on this day, you can buy it. And then that kind of turned into, okay, well, what if I create a catalog, but I do it one by one? So I create, let's say this catalog is going to have seven pieces in it, but I drop seven different pieces. So single garments, one by one, that then builds the catalog. And then I redrop every garment together in the catalog. So you only get, I don't know, there's super limited drops for 1 through 7. And if you couldn't get your hands on that, you can wait till the full catalog and there'll be another sellout, right? Again, these are just examples to show like the formats that I'm sort of thinking in my head. I think it's something I'll test because again, there's no rules. Like I can do it the way the fashion industry has been doing it or the way a lot of these new brands have been doing it, but like that's not the way to do it. I can do it any way I want. And so I'm just going to test and see what happens.
This is called speed questions. I'm going to ask you like 5 or 6 questions.
Oh, I'm so bad at these.
And you set the timer.
Oh, geez, this is quick. I don't do good at quick. I got long answers, as you can see.
Go. Okay. Your celebrity crush?
I'd never know.
No. Okay. First thing you think when you think comedy?
Stand-up comedy. I'm a huge fan.
Something that starts with the letter J.
Jordan. That was very vain.
5 plus 6.
11.
Your favorite sport?
To watch?
Just in general, I guess.
Ooh, surfing.
Favorite color?
Great.
Favorite tattoo you have?
That's so tough. Probably the Pokemon right here, Alakazam.
Someone that inspired you. Do you have an idol like growing up?
Ironically, this pertains to apparel. Ralph Lauren. I watched his documentary. Someone put me on a Ralph Lauren. I watched the documentary. I mean, even now, we're having the conversation where, like, Ralph Lauren just hit its 50th anniversary a couple years ago. And, like, it's more prominent today than it's ever been. To have a product, a tangible product, that is more relevant 50 years later, that's aged like fine wine 50 years, to me is like such an inspiration, especially coming from someone that at least appears to do it strictly for the love of what it is, the love of the game. To take myself out of the mentality that, like, we're all Justin Bieber. Like, I feel like there's a wow factor to seeing Justin Bieber out and about. Like, he's a person, and how I analyze every person, like, would me and that person get along? Yes. Great. Okay. Maybe we'd get along. Maybe we'd have a great conversation. We would not get along. Okay. Then I don't care. So I have a hard time idolizing people. I'm not saying I don't, but like, there's no one that's really like top of mind. And I honestly think I long for that. And I'm constantly searching for inspiration from people because I want that. Maybe it's just like toxic individuality where I'm just like, I don't want to be anyone else. I've strayed away from it in the past, but I do want to find inspiration from people because nothing is really original.
Growing up, I always like looked after Hillary Duff. I thought she was a very positive image.
Kind of look like Hillary
Duff. Do I really?
You give big Hillary Duff vibes.
I love Hillary Duff. I've always channeled her since I was like a little girl. And she's put a lot of positive messages and ideas in my life that kept me just dreaming and going and believing in what people would say to me, impossible or that I'm delusional. Dreams do come true. Or like, that's kind of like the messages she was sending to Lizzie McGuire.
Yeah.
Wherever me. And then even through her music, she had a lot of messages through her music that were very like inspirational and allowed me to believe in myself as a little girl. So I think it kind of changes maybe how you are as an adult, like what you go after and like the things that you believe in from a young age, you know, just inspiration and like people to believe in. You are on a spiritual journey and you explained to me that you were trying to grow your relationship with the Almighty. Tell us a little bit about what that looks like with the spiritual journey.
It's been crazy. So I was raised Christian. I have sort of a harsh opinion on that. I think as my spiritual journey develops, it'll probably change a bit. But like one of the realizations I had when I started sort of finding my faith again was like, and maybe this is me just blaming my childhood where like I'm frustrated that I didn't kindle a relationship with God then. But like, it's so hard in my opinion for a child, and maybe it builds a foundation to relate the Bible to their life. Like the Bible is scripture and there needs to be a relatability aspect, right? For example, when I started finding my faith again, one of the big things was tithing. And I never really like knew what tithing really was, but what would happen is I would always give without asking for return. Like I'd love paying for my friends. Like I would always pay for people's dinners, and a million people out there can attest to this, but I would never do it to make myself, I mean, maybe it's from a selfish reason, I guess you're always giving to make yourself feel better, but like I wasn't doing it expecting anything in return. And I would do that all the time. And then at the same time, I would always tell my family, I'd have these conversations with people close to me, be like, dude, money finds its way to me in crazy ways, right? I had a moment one time listening to a podcast that explained tithing, and I was like, oh, excuse my language. I was like I've been unintentionally blessed by God without realizing it. I've been unintentionally tithing. And so what happened was I had to live these things out to relate them back to scripture. And it keeps going on. There's a couple different things that I've related back to scripture. And that's sort of like my ongoing relationship is like these things in my life are unraveling and I'm sort of like backdating it to God. I'm like, oh, well, I went through this season and all these crazy things happened where I was like, I couldn't explain them at the time. Maybe I'd blame the universe, whatever it is. And now I'm sort of just like, oh, the universe is just God. Like I just relabeled God then as the universe because I didn't have a relationship. And that's sort of how I fell back into it. But when you're a child, that just sounds like nearly impossible to do, right? Like you don't have the level of consciousness to be able to relate scripture to your life. And so as a kid, it just seemed like a chore. It was just like, oh, church is a Sunday. Like I want to go to the skate park and I have to go to church. And you're in church, and they're like, oh, I've heard the same scripture 400 times, and I still don't know what it means. Again, I want to reiterate, I think I'm grateful. I am grateful, but I'm grateful for my parents, I think, because they built the foundation for me, at least. At least now I have this basic knowledge of the gospel, and like I know some scriptures and I know the story of Jesus to some extent, though I had to realize I was quite naive in the space. And now I'm in a journey where, like I said, I just keep relating my life back to scripture. I've always been attracted to true believers. And again, no one's perfect, everyone sins, but people who have a really strong morality built into them based upon the Bible and based upon their relationship with God. And so because I've surrounded myself with so many people like that, they've luckily enough taught me so many things now. Like all those people that I just wanted to be around because they were such good people with good energy and they lived such, like, have now also caught me in a season where now I'm rekindling my relationship, and a lot of them have helped me again realize these things. I'm like, oh my God, I could go on and on. I will say this, and I want to relate to everybody in saying this, and maybe you can relate somewhere. I'm not sure what your relationship is with God, but I used to get really frustrating hearing people talk about their relationship with God because I felt like, how do you talk to him? Like, I never had anything weird happen. Like, that's, you start doubting things. You're like, did that really happen? Because I've never had anything happen, right? And so when I speak like this, I always reiterate, I'm like, I am on a working relationship with God. Like, God, the more I've leaned in, the more I've felt God leaning in. I've never had anything like spiritually unusual happen in my life until I started leaning into God. And so coincidence or not, that's up to me to decide. But it sort of gets to a point where, like, when you make God and the Bible and scripture and spirituality the forefront of your life, like, you can feel yourself change. You can feel the way you act, the way you think, and in reality, just the way you feel change, because we're all sitting here on our phones all day. We're all going down these like empty paths of material items and all these things. And we all have desires, which is, again, something I found out that, like, God put those desires in our heart for a reason. So, like, some of those desires will be fulfilled at the right time. But a lot of those desires, for the most part, are empty, right? And so constantly we get these little dopamine rushes from our phone or drugs, partying, whatever it is. But when you have God in your life, you start feeling full without anything. And that's sort of like how I feel my relationship building, and why I just keep going in and in, is because, like, I keep feeling more and more full with less and less, like with the requirement for less and less. And so that's just like why I think the path is sort of addicting. God's just waiting for you to lean in. He's always there, but he still wants you to lean in, and he will lean in.
Yeah. There's been those moments in my life, really, where I was at an all-time low and I just didn't know what to do. And I think once I started to lean in, and I started to see, like, I don't want to say magic, but I started to see things happening that were like beyond me, that were like, this is the help or the sign or the guidance I need. And things have always happened for me in ways that are almost unspeakable. I'm like, I don't know how this is possible, but we know it's because we're praying, we're asking for it. My parents put me in Bible study at a very young age. I was the same way. I was like, what am I doing? This is mature. I have to be here and I need to be there. It wasn't until I had these moments in my life where I had ultimately hit rock bottom. And I was like, I'm going to turn it to something spiritual, something the higher power. And it's been great for me too. So I've been on that journey for a while. I know my brother just tapped into it recently, got baptized.
Oh, exciting.
Yeah, have you ever been baptized?
When I was a kid.
Never been baptized. I'm one day, but I'll wait for that moment when I feel like I'm ready.
I'm the same way. And it's sad to say, because my hesitation to get baptized, because I feel like I won't get baptized and feel like until I feel I am giving my life to God. And that I don't like, because it feels like, well, right now, then why am I not ready to give my life to God? Like, what doubts do I have? What more do I need? And is what I need on the other side of giving my life to God? And I don't have the answer. I am slowly getting to a point when, like, I don't know, I just have a lot of questions with it that I've asked, and through my pastors and my friends, and like getting very close. But I think I needed to see more tangible work in my life. And I know that's more of like it's more of like an exchange-based relationship that you probably shouldn't have with God, but like, that's how it felt. And ironically, not because I felt that way, but like, it has felt like I've gotten so much more from God. So it's like, I don't see myself holding back from continuing to lean in. I think I'm just going to continuously keep leaning in and eventually be living a very like spirituality-centered life. And that maybe hopefully we'll get to a point where I'm like, yeah, I'm ready.
I think it's important to know that if you're not ready, don't do it.
Yeah.
I see you're like, you're not drinking, you're not smoking, but you do go work out. So you have a healthy lifestyle, drinking water. Okay?
Water and a lot of coffee, yeah.
You like to cook?
I love to cook everything. Last night, I made balsamic glazed chicken with Brussels and tomatoes.
What's a piece of advice for somebody who is just getting started?
I'll sound like a broken record, but know why you're doing it. Make sure the reason you're doing it has nothing to do with financial gain. And I actually got reminded that again recently in a very great conversation I had, which is like, find your why. Like, knowing your why for why you're doing things is not only super important for yourself, and obviously it's important for like the story you're gonna tell, right? Like, if you're an artist, know your why for why you're creating. That's what people are supporting you through, right? In the same way, if you're a content creator, like, know why you're doing it, because people, like, that will come across on camera, and people won't just be supporting you for the entertainment, they'll be supporting you because your why is like bleeding through you, right? They're like, oh, this person's on this mission and I want to support this mission. If you're doing it for money, it's just going to be an empty pit, to be honest. And there's actually, in my opinion, less likely of a chance that you will find financial gain. That is the overarching goal.
I think there's a lot that you have to put in before you can even see money come. I agree. I think people need to kind of find a passion for it. If you truly don't have a passion for it, then you're going to be wasting your time. We're not wasting your time. It's going to be just a lot of work. Have you heard of Creator Now?
Mm-hmm.
You have. Do you know what it is?
I actually just found out, I think, if we're talking about the same thing, there's those guys who film like movies for creators. Like that's their, they like had a connected Creator Now, and Creator Now helped them get to one of those creators they were trying to make a movie for. I think it was Creator Now. They became a part of Creator Now as well. I actually don't know much about it. Would you like to tell me about it?
Yeah, I'd love to tell you.
Okay.
Creator Now provides you with the education, community, and resources to...
You should memorize it and then tell me it in one thing. That's what you should do. Yeah.
Creator Now provides you with the education, community, resources, and support to supercharge your path towards becoming a full-time creator and sponsored.
What do they do? Like, what exactly do they do from your perspective?
It gives you the opportunity to get one-on-one learning and teachings from the most successful people in the creator economy.
And it's like online, like workshop style stuff?
Yeah, they always have like in-person meetups, and like depending on where you are, they have circles and plans. We're gonna play Who Are They?
Okay.
I'm gonna show you a series of like 5 or 6 different people.
Okay.
And if you don't know who they are, then say the person.
You're gonna show me them. I'm so bad with names. By the way, it's my like kryptonite. Jenna Marbles. Harry Potter. Jim Carrey. Logan Paul, Machine Gun Kelly, Drew,
oh my God.
Tom Cruise, Jake Paul, Jim Carrey, Omen. Did I win?
Yes, you did.
Oh, I'm actually super culturally aware. I keep up. I study.
Same. I think being present in just the space of comedy or social media or even music.
Hey, the dream one was smart because most people probably didn't see that guy.
The fruits by the foot challenge of your
bit. Oh, no. What if it's the ground? You know, I haven't had a fruit roll up. Like, I don't even, it's been probably a decade. Oh, I have to beat you at this. Yeah, I'm gonna lose that. She ain't got it. So what do? I just gotta get this whole thing in my mouth? And wait, I gotta get off the paper. Yeah, I'm about to eat the paper. All right, hold up. Where'd your paper go?
So.
Oh, this. Dude. No, no, look. Yeah. Oh my God, wait, I don't want to eat this. I thought you had me.
I don't know what happened.
Did you eat the whole thing? Like, yeah, I can't do that. A coffee and a fruit by the foot? No fruit by the foot for me. Has anyone won all 3 games? I'm competitive.
One person.
Did you let me win? No, you thought you had it. Thought you had it, huh?
Oh, by the way, since you won all 3 games, this video, if it gets 100 likes and 5,000 views, we'll send you a piece of merch. You can pick out whichever one you want. Hit the subscribe button. Give this video a big thumbs up. On the Who Are They was outstanding because I thought maybe like even Dream you might not get.
I almost said Shane. Yeah. I almost said Shane Dawson. He gives me Shane Dawson vibes. That's a collab waiting to see. Dream x Shane Dawson. I feel like that's a super fair collab.
Well, that was awesome that you knew all that. You have a brother.
Mm-hmm.
And he's older.
Mm-hmm.
And he's...
He did. He had the child on the 4th.
On the 4th.
So literally, what's today? Like the 20th. Yeah, like 2 weeks ago. That's the first time. Coolest thing. It is a cool thing. Me and my brother have been, we're like 2 years and 7 months apart. And we've been like best friends since we were children. I don't think it's happened yet, but like now that the little guy's here, it's like, I know that we're going to get to experience all the things we got to experience together as kids with his kid. Do you think you hit this age? You might relate to this when, I don't know how many nieces and nephews you have, so maybe you don't, but like holidays kind of start to suck when you turn like 16. Like I don't enjoy holidays that much anymore because like the nostalgia is gone. Like I don't feel like a kid anymore. Halloween is boring. Everyone's trying to party. I'm trying to go trick-or-treating, you know what I'm saying? Christmas just like goes by in a second. I think once you have kids, you sort of get to like re-experience it from a different angle. He's not my child, but he's a part of the family. Like because me and my brother were so close growing up, I can't wait to see him father a child who's almost like, he is soon going to be at the age that I can remember me and my brother, which is just a crazy concept.
I'm sure during the growth of the child, you'll start to feel different ways as time changes. Good to be able to have those experiences. Like,
how many do you have?
I have 2 nephews, twin boys.
Oh my God. Are they conjoined?
No. I saw the funniest video today. Do you know Bert Kreischer? No. The comedian who always has his shirt off. Big old belly. Shout out Bert. He's the man. And then do you watch New Girl? You never seen New Girl. Okay, you're going to watch New Girl. You're going to start. Okay. Whatever. It was a character in New Girl, the actor, and Bert Kreischer. And he tells him he has twins. And he goes, conjoined. He's dead serious. Conjoined? And he's like, what? It's like. So yeah, I had to say that. I just wanted to throw you off a little bit.
Isn't there that's a call?
Well, they're twins, yeah. Well, that's the normal question is like, are they fraternal or identical? A conjoined really just throws people off.
I mean, what are the chances of that?
Very rare. It's one in a billion, I think. Yeah.
Also two nieces.
Do you love being an aunt?
So holidays for me is babysitting.
Got it. Much. Did you enjoy more when it was new? Like, did you want a babysitter? Like, yo, give me the kids. Like, I'll take care of them.
Like, oh, like, they're cute. Like, I'll play with them for a few minutes. And, like, just because they're just such a unit.
Yeah. I'm happy you started a podcast. It's exciting. Yeah, thanks for having me.
I kind of like to call it more like a pop show, but I want to be different. I think everyone's doing the podcast streaming thing, and I'm like, I just want a talk show. Like, I want it to be visual or play games.
You want to be like the new iCarly is what you're saying.
I don't know. I never watched iCarly.
Ever?
Yeah. I told you, I don't really watch TV that much.
All right, well, if you're starting a talk show, yeah, you got to watch iCarly. So you guys are watching TV, it seems. Trust me, I don't like TV either, but like, it's such a waste of time.
I watch YouTube to consume for business.
iCarly's for business purposes. You have a pod show.
Pod show. And you know what? It makes it easier because not that many people are calling your show a pod show. So I can be like, this is the best pod show. Most viewed. Number one.
Yeah, all right.
Best creators on this pod of 2023. Like, I can like make these certain statements and it be.
It's like being the best conjoined twin. You know what I mean? There's like not a lot of competition.
And I've also learned the business side of content creating. So I feel like it's really important to just have these things ready to go. When guests come, like I try to accommodate them as much as possible. And make them comfortable.
If you make like some bags, you know what I mean? Like take me to lunch or something, you know what I'm saying? Yeah.
That's a wrap. Bye y'all.
It's gonna get that in like 2 years and I'm gonna be like, you should have given me seltzer water.
Oh, that has a
I'm burping all the time.